Always read manufacturer's safety instructions, and most of all, have fun.
Hello, Andrew, back again, and we're going to do some more work now with the Record Regent lathe. I'm going to introduce you to the new range of tools that Record have brought out as well. I've got the spindle roughing set here, and that's the spindle roughing set there. They come in this handy pouch, which is going to be useful for me for demonstrating. And I'll be able to put them back in the pouch and then use them when I go to the different shows. But I've made a little shelf here, and to go into it is the set. So in the set, what we've got a spindle roughing gouge to go in there. We've got a spindle gouge, and we've got a parting tool. Sizes of the tools are a 1-inch spindle roughing gouge, 3/8 spindle gouge, and a 1/8 parting tool. So that's 25mm, 10mm, and 3mm. So that's the pouch that come in. We're going to do some turning. I've got a piece on here that I was practicing with before. I'm going to tape it off. And what we'll do is just put some material between centres to start with. Now what I suggest is, when you first start turning, get yourself some pine. Go to your local builders merchants and buy yourself a dozen 8-foot lengths of pine and cut them off around about 150mm, 6 inches, to turn them down from square to round and practice beads, curves and V-cuts. Well, I'll put a cross in the end here because I'm using a 4-prong drive. And all I want to do is apply pressure to the actual 4-prong drive in order to be able to have the drive bite into the cross there. If I didn't do that, the alternative would be to actually take the 4-prong drive out, use a rubber mallet, and go outside onto a piece of concrete and just tap the rubber mallet to create 4 indentations from the 4-prong drive. So right, we've got a pencil here. I'll put that back in the cupboard because I don't need it at the moment. And we'll just pop the door on the Record cupboard there. I made the door so as it was easy to go back on. And just push in with the turn button, and there we are. We can mark the material on the other end to find the centre. And to do that, a finger gauge. What I do is I protrude the pencil about 10 to 12 millimetres out from my finger, and I make a line around there, and a finger gauge, a line there, and that gives me a smaller section inside. Now, I've got my ordinary glasses on here, and they are distance glasses, and the problem with these is I can't really see close up, and I don't actually need glasses to see close up, which is quite fortunate. So I'm going to take these off now. I've got a little Gilbert the glasses holder here. Gilbert was kindly given to me by a friend of mine when I was demonstrating at a wood turning club. And Gilbert, what he does, he actually makes them. His name's on the bottom, Pete. And he makes them and he sells them in aid of the sight support. And I believe his son has a vision challenge, so he sells them for the sight support. But that's a nice little spindle exercise with a couple of eyes and a nose. It's a project we're going to do later on, and he's ideal just to hold my glasses. So I've got my safety glasses here. These come from straightlines.com, and I really like these safety glasses. I particularly like the yellow ones because they do, I don't know, they make it nice and bright and you can see easily, and they do illuminate the. They say they're very good for driving as well. I've never tried them for driving, but I'll have to try them. So there's the centre there, so I'm just going to eyeball that through there, make a centre line there, and then what I can do is just put a little hole in with a brad awl, and I'll put the brad awl into there, just a little hole in with the brad awl there, and then I can just get that on the point of the revolving tailstock centre. Now this revolving tailstock centre that you get standard with the Record Regent self-ejecting, it's got a ring centre on it. There's a little point in there and a ring centre, and what that does is it actually, the point centralises the material, but the ring centre means that you've got a 10mm ring there for repositioning. It's ideal if you want to take material out from in between centres and then pop it back into between centres again. You can centre it up much easier. This is one of my new Lovell smocks that I've had made, and they have a pencil spot in the sleeve, which is quite handy because that's another thing that I keep losing. And I've made a few of these gilberts up, and I've drilled a hole through the centre of there, 10mm hole, to put my pencil in, because it's so easy to lose the pencils. So anyhow, I could either put it in my arm or put them there for now. So right, I'm going to put the material between centres, just a bit of cheap pine that I bought from the builders merchants, and I'll be able to lock off the tailstock and then wind in the revolving tailstock centre until it bites onto those two V's there, and there we are, we're ready to turn. The only other consideration I do like to make before I start turning, I do this every day, is I'll take a garrison block and I'll just clean the material, or the lathe I should say, with a garrison block, and I rub the tool rest like that. What I tend to do is pull the banjo out, give it a little rub underneath there, rub the bed of the lathe. I've already done this actually, but I'm just showing you, it's good practice just to get any corrosion off, tap it and it'll come off, because there's always moisture in the air. It doesn't matter where you work, there's always moisture in the air. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to tip the tool rest into there. I'll move on to the overhead view and we'll put the tool rest on there. Check that it's not catching, and there we can see it from the overhead view, and I've got the speed turned right the way down on the variable speed. So I'll pop the lathe on. The lathe comes on. This is on a big magnet, so you can see there we've got a zero indicator on there. Now I've got it on its highest belt so it'll run its highest speed. I'm only turning small spindles. So I've checked it by hand, I've rotated by hand to make sure it's not catching either the tool rest or anything else. The tool rest itself is about 6mm below the quill. The quill is the centre of this piece of steel here, and it's around about 6mm, no farther than 6mm away from its closest point there. Solid it slightly so that you've got that position nicely there. And we're going to start off speed turned right the way down with the spindle roughing gouge. The spindle roughing gouge is designed to turn material between centres. The spindle roughing gouge should never be used on a ball blank. The reason being that it has a tang, whereas a ball gouge is cylindrical. And I'll talk about it in more detail when we go on to turn a ball. But the one thing to remember is this one's got a label on there, it says roughing gouge, it's a spindle roughing gouge, the green label. So we start the lathe up, twist the stop, which is a safety feature, before we start the lathe up, and there we're on the slowest speed, and the slowest speed there is around, it says 1180 on the dial here, so I'm going to take it up to about 2000 revs. There we are, we're on the 2000 rev mark there. I've got good boots on. I've got work trousers. I've got a smock to protect my clothes. I've got goggles on to protect my eyes. And when I come to do some sanding, I will also wear a respirator to protect my lungs. So I'm ready to go. I've got a nice sharp tool. The tool itself, the tools are sharp when they come out of the packet. So I'm just going to show you how the tool works against the material there. So I've got my thumb on the top, fingers underneath, and I'm going to go from left to right. The reason I'm going from left to right is because I'm naturally right-handed. You tend to find people who go from right to left are left-handed. So I'm going from left to right, from high to low, just to take off the hive front. And I've got my comb positioned about 25mm away from the cutting edge, and my hands are wrapped underneath. It's what I call underhand grip. And also the tool is locked into the side, so it's a body motion. And then I'll go from the opposite side, from the right to the left, and take off the high pump down to the low pump. I've never come onto the material from that end when it's in the square section, or that end when it's in the square section, in case it splits up. Now that we've got the material in a position where we can actually travel from one side to the other, and if you notice again, the tool's locked into my side, thumb on there, fingers underneath, and I'm literally rocking from one angle to the other. I call it dancing with the wood. Switch that off, automatically locks it there. Now you can see it's rough. Spindle rough and gouge, the material's rough. And it's pine, so it's bound to be rough. It's just a soft material. But the thing is, working with pine, it's a great material to be able to improve your tool skills. And I can show you straight away how you can improve your tool skills. And what we're going to do, we're going to lift up the tool so we're 6mm below the quill before. Now I've lifted it up 6mm above the quill. I'm getting it as close as I can to the material there, which is around about 8mm. I do like to keep it 6mm. These lathes come with different size tool rests as well. The tool rest I've got with this one is the standard tool rest, but I probably will get myself some of the smaller tool rests as well and build up the kit. So now I'm going to start this again, but I'm actually going to turn the speed up. Don't forget, it's a safety feature. Unlock there, start. Start it again. I'm going to speed up and I'm going to take it up out around about 2,500-600 there. Thumb on the top, fingers underneath, and I've got the tool locked into my side here. There is the bevel of the tool. The bevel is rubbing, but it's not cutting. It's rubbing, but not cutting. So I'm just going to cut halfway there, and then we'll look at the overhead camera. From the overhead camera, we should be able to see a measurable difference in the actual smoothness of the material just by lifting that up. I'll just see if I can zoom in on that, and then you can see the difference. There we are. Reposition the camera, and I'm going to turn the rest of that bevel there, bevel rubbing straight across. Got bevel contact, the bevel is flowing across the material. A nice, steady, even cut. And that's the spindle roughing gouge. So what I've done, I've took a piece of material from square to round. The next tool I'm going to use in the spindle set is the 6mm parting tool. Now what I want to do is I just want to clean up the end of the material here with the 6mm parting tool. Thumb on the top, fingers underneath, and arcing cut and in. So there we are, I'm just cutting into there with the parting tool, so I've squared up the end. So what I'm going to do now is I'll just take a rule, and what have we got here? This piece of material. We've got 140. So we'll go to the centre, 70mm. And it's a good idea to start with measurements so that you instead of just guessing where things are, you're better off if you just start with the measurements, and then that's actually 71 it wants to be, it's 142. So start with that point there, and then these are nice little handy rulers, little stainless steel ruler. So all I'm going to do is just hold the pencil as if it's a tool, and just wind it around there, and there's a pencil mark there. I'll also give myself some other measurements. I'm going to measure into there 10 millimetres or 3/8 of an inch. And 3/8 of an inch or 10 millimetres into there. And I'll also make a mark on there like that. Now if your eyesight's good and you can see those marks revolving at that speed, you can just make a mark like that and then you play. So that little mark in there, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a bead. So this is the third tool in your armoury of spindle turning tools. This is your spindle gouge. So this one, this spindle gouge, it's the grind that's straight out of the packet. So if I just put my hand under there, or my hand under there, you can see that's the grind that's straight out of the packet. That's the traditional spindle gouge grind. So I'm going to turn a bead there. My finger is in line with the flute. My thumb is there. And there's the bevel rubbin. Now the bevel's rubbin, it's not cutting. If I lift the bevel up at the back, there's starting to cut. Now four rounds into a bead and out. Physically move your hand round. And then four rounds into a bead and out. So there you've got a bead and you've got a V-cut. V-cut into there. V-cut into there. And just tidy that little bit there. So now we've got a bead in the centre and I'm going to put a bead or a half bead on each 10mm in. Don't try and go straight from there down to there. Do it in little bite-sized chunks. So a bevel rubbin, about a third of the way along, lift up, round, and into there. Again, bevel rubbin. At the moment, the centre of that bevel is pointing to 12 o'clock. What we are going to do is elevate that up, turn it as we're elevating it up, and take it round to 3 o'clock. So again, another third in, lift up, bevel rubbin, there it comes, round, from 12 o'clock to 3 o'clock, and again to the pencil line, 12 o'clock, round to 3 o'clock. And can you see, all the time, my finger, it's a natural movement, it's going from the 12 o'clock position down to the 3 o'clock position, and the hand is just articulating. What we don't want to do is be holding it like that, because it's uncomfortable on our wrist to do that, whereas if your finger's out there, and you go around from 12 to 3, it's comfortable. Now this time, physically, swing your finger around to the side of the flute. Again the third, bevel rubbin, round, 12 o'clock to 9 o'clock. Another third, round, 12 o'clock to 9 o'clock, onto the pencil line, pick up the foot, 12 o'clock to 9 o'clock. So there you've got a bead in the middle, and you've got half bead, a V-cut there and a V-cut there. So we'll stop the material and I'll just pop my spindle gouge back into the tool shelf and my parting tool back into the tool shelf. There we are. Grab my ruler and then what I'm going to do is just take a measurement between the half bead and the V-cut. Now that's 50mm, so 25mm, 50mm 2 inches, centre 2 inches 1 inch, same on here, and 25mm on there. So there we've got our measurements. Now that's the centre of the cove. We're going to cut a cove. And what we'll do is we'll give ourselves a reference there. And yeah, we'll give ourselves the reference. This is one of the first spindle gouges that I received from Record, and this was one of the prototype tools. You can see I've got my little brand on there. I put it on there for when I went to Austria to demonstrate with Record. So that's your half inch spindle gouge there, and again you can see the swept back grind on there. And I have a 3/8 spindle gouge, which is the same as the 3/8 gouge that we got in the kit. So unlock, set it away. So there, this time thumb on here, Again, don't try and go from there all the way into the middle, and from there all the way into the middle. Little bite-sized chunks. A third. And down to the centre of the core. Same again. So I've my thumb on there, my fingers on here, it's a body movement. I'm locked in, I'm going around, and I've got this tool locked firmly into my side. I've got a good stance. My feet are about 600 millimetres apart. Round the hair again, good stance, and this time I'm going to go the other way. A third, two thirds, and then the final push. To blend the core in. At that point there, just come back to here, blend it into there, and there we've got a core running into there. I'll just lose that line there. That's it. Same on this side. Again, I'm right-handed, so I always start going from left to right rather than from right to left. So a third. Two. You can wrap your finger under the toe rest if you want to. Two thirds. And then from here, a third, two thirds. And blend it into there to the same size. And practice that cut like that. So there we are. Now, the only other thing I'm going to do is make a reference point to here and to here. So again, using my 3mm parting tool, I'm just going to make a reference point there, and a reference point there, and there we've got the same size on each side. We've got a curve, a half a bead, a V-cut, and a bead. So we'll stop that at that. As I say, this is a piece of pine. You would, if you could, it would be a good idea to make 100 of those just with your pine. Just practice your curves, your beads, and your V-cuts. And your tool handling and your confidence will build up no end. And you're just using a cheap bit of pine. So what I'm going to do now is just show you how we'll sand up this piece of pine. And we'll take some abrasives and take it through from... We'll start with 80 grit and we'll take it through to 600 grit.
I detached the audio off from this particular part of the video because it was just too noisy, but what we've got the extractor there. I'm using the abrasive underneath at about the 6 o'clock position so that the dust goes straight into the extractor.
So there we are, that's the project finished. We've sanded it through from 80 grit through to 600. We're using the chestnut mesh abrasive. I used the extractor to get rid of the visual dust. The AC400 above gets rid of the very, very fine dust, and in between dusts I always use a soft brush to get rid of the grit, and what that does is that stops the grit from scratching with the second abrasive or the next abrasive that you use. Hope you've enjoyed this little demo and that it's inspired you to go out there and buy some pine and just practice your cuts, your beads, your curves and your V-cuts. So always read your safety manufacturer's instructions, always wear your correct safety equipment, your glasses, your goggles, your smock, your trousers, your good strong boots, and most of all, have yourself some fun in the workshop. Thanks for watching.